Well, good evening. My name is Ashok Gurung. I'm the director of India-China Institute. And it's really my great privilege and honor to welcome you all to this very special conversation that we're going to have today, something that's a topic that's very close to my heart on multiple levels. This week has been really what I would call the new school, ultimate social justice week. You know, we have amazing, you know, people passing through the university. I know downstairs, Bell Hook is speaking. Tomorrow we have Cornell West and Bell Hook. So considering all these people speaking on social justice, I'm really thankful to all of you for choosing to come to this event, which is equally important, if not more important. I think at the new school, we have a tradition of thinking, at least trying to claim that we think outside the box. Often we do. And within the university, India-China Institute occupies a particular space where we look at India-China-US together. And issues of inequality, social justice are also very important to us. You know, in our various engagements, whether it's focused around research, teaching, or building a community of engaged scholars and experts. So today, I think when this opportunity came, I could not think of a better person to help me both conceptualize and moderate, or I would say lead, this particular conversation. So here I'm really, really grateful, and I want to thank Professor Smita Narula, who now I consider as a good friend, for really agreeing to you know, work with me over the past few months to think about how to use this rare occasion, you know, and I think you will understand when I say rare occasion, when three, you know, really wonderful you know, leaders, they happen to focus on and come from Dalit community, they happen to converge in New York. It's very rare. I think it's much more common for many Nepalese nowadays, especially if you come from a certain socioeconomic background, to pass through New York. But for three top, you know, leaders from Dalit community to be at the same place, that's really, really rare. So we didn't want to miss this opportunity. So that's why, you know, we thought, you know, it would be great to have a conversation. And you will understand, you know, what I mean by conversation, because, you know, we have designed the format in such a way that you know, that you will also be able to engage with our you know, esteemed guests today. So a bit about Smita Narula. She is currently a visiting research scholar at Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute at Hunter College, formerly a UN Special Rapporteur on Right to Food, and also a faculty director of Center for Human Rights and Global Justice at NYU School of Law. She has been working in human rights for more than 17 years. Both in her practice as well as scholarship, you know, she really focuses on issues of, you know, really rights to equality, non-discrimination, food issues, economic globalization, and human rights, broadly speaking. She has authored numerous reports and academic articles on these subjects. And what is interesting is when I was looking at her, I would say, you know, she says in a modest, you know, CV, 12 pages long, she really has what I call nice, scary resume. You know. It's really impressive. You know, a graduate of Brown University, and later on JD from Harvard Law School. She was the editor-in-chief of Harvard Human Rights Journal, and really has gone on to do amazing things. Someone really, what I, you know, aspire to, you know, become and tell my students whenever I get a chance, really this idea of engaged scholar and reflective practitioner. I think she embodies all of that together. So aside from her stellar, you know, background, she's really truly a warm, warm person who deeply cares about and understands why, you know, discrimination in this, you know, era, this age, you know, is simply, you know, stupid, B, you know, it doesn't make economic sense, you know, and it's morally wrong. So I'm really delighted that Smita, you have agreed to really moderate this discussion. Now I just ask you to lead us through. Thank you.
Ashok, had I known I would have spent so much time on my CV, I would never have sent it to you, nor agreed to come and be here. But of course, I'm delighted to be here. This is really about our wonderful guests and activists who are in town and who embody not only decades of innovative thinking and struggle on caste discrimination, but really embody what I see as some of the most effective strategies for dealing with an issue that is so entrenched and so pernicious and so deeply ingrained in South Asian society, but also in many African countries, in many other places where caste discrimination or one's caste is wholly determinative of their ability to live a life of dignity as a citizen of their community, and of course their ability to access basic needs and enjoy fundamental human rights. We are going to start the conversation, actually bring you into the conversation with an 11-minute clip from a group which I had the honor of co-founding many years ago called the International Dalit Solidarity Network, which is a network of organizations and groups from all over the world united to help support Dalit activists in caste-affected countries raise these issues at the global scale and also deepen their engagement domestically. So this video is just a snapshot of the problem that we're talking about, and then I'll introduce our panelists today to start a conversation about what we do about the problems that we're talking about.
Violations against Dalits include exclusion, torture, rape, slavery and murder, and fundamentally breach the principles of equality and non-discrimination laid down in international human rights law. Across the globe, there are 260 million people living in segregation in caste systems. While the majority live in South Asia, where they call themselves Dalits, caste discrimination also affects the lowest castes in migrant communities and in Africa, Japan, and Yemen.
معلش حق قالوا الطم والخادم معلش قالوا الخادم مع معانا في الاخر ولا احنا حاجه التنكه دي بخمسة ريال نبيل بقى تريكات مطلوب طجا نقري على انفسنا نبقوها لنا لا يدرسوا ولا يعملوا اي حاجه ولا والله العظيم ان احنا نقص قياع نقص غضب على حكم ربي سرحت سامينا ضمة ضربني المام ما قريناش نخبت لا خدام المغوطون نحنا ما عززهدوش بيت لا بتن حرقنا لا بتن مت
The way the system works is that you are born into an inherited caste and your caste can never be changed. If you are unlucky enough to be born into the lowest castes, you are considered an unclean and subhuman servant to those above you.
ਉਹ ਸਾਡੇ ਲਿਬਾਸ ਨੂੰ ਵੇਖ ਕੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਗਰੀਬਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਵੇਖ ਕੇ ਤੇ ਉਹ ਪਰੇ 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 ਹੋਣ ਗਿਆ ਚਾਹੇ ਨਰਸਾਂ ਹੋਣ ਚਾਹੇ ਡਾਕਟਰ ਹੋਣ ਚਾਹੇ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਹੋ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਬਾਹਰ ਨਾ ਦੇ ਸਨ ਆ ਕਸਮ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਬਰਤਨ ਕੋਈ ਨਹੀਂ ਜੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੇ ਭੰਨੇ ਟੁੱਟੇ ਨੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਬਿਆਨ ਵੀ ਦਿੱਤਾ ਤਾਂ ਬਰਤਨ ਉਹ ਦੇਣਗੇ ਜਿਨ੍ਹਾਂ ਨੇ ਕਦੀ ਉਹਦੇ 'ਚ ਖਾਣਾ ਨਾ ਖਾਇਆ ਹੋਵੇ ਉਹ ਸਾਡੇ ਅੱਗੇ ਬਰਤਨ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਰੱਖਣੇ ਨੇ ਕੂਲਰ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਪਾਣੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਪੀਣ ਦੇਣਾ
Caste discrimination prevents Dalits from equal access to water, healthcare, education, and other basic services. It even extends to humanitarian relief work. Your caste dictates that you must do the lowest and dirtiest tasks in society, such as cleaning human excrement and sweeping garbage or working in bonded labor. Your untouchable status typically excludes you from alternative work and binds you in extreme poverty. These Dalit men in India are forced to clean the city sewers. Many of these workers die after being lowered into the poisonous gases.
अच्छा तो आपको पता है दो बंदों की मौत हो गई है अभी ऐसे गिर के उसमें तो फिर भी आप ये काम कर रहे हैं
पेट के लिए कर रहे हैं गंदा काम बुरा लग
रहा है Discrimination in education is also rampant and at school Dalits are often made to sit at the back separated from the non-Dalit children and are not properly taught by teachers.
रिप्ति आपकी यहाँ कहीं बच्चों के साथ खाने में भेदभाव होता है क्या?
हाँ होता है लाडू के होता है ना वहाँ अलग बैठाते हैं बच्चों के लिए खाने।
अब किस तरह से अलग बैठाते हैं?
लग जैसे सारे सर्वन लोग एक साथ बैठते हैं ना तो मतलब हमारे लोगों को अलग दे देते खाना।
Dalit children are often victims of corporal punishment. And are forced to do especially demeaning chores that the other children do not do. If you are a Dalit woman, the cocktail of gender and caste raises an even bigger barrier to tear down. In India and Nepal, Dalits and tribals are the main victims of sex trafficking and may inherit prostitution through their caste. This is the case for young Benita, whose caste offers her no alternatives.
चौदह वर्ष बच्चाले यो काम गर्ने हो त भन्नु न अब ब्याज अहिले त पर्ने मेरो अनि अब बाध्यले खाना पुग्दैन लाउन पुग्दैन क्या आमै तिमी नै पाल्छौ भने अब अघि मैले पाले अब त ठुली पनि छोरी आमै कोसो पाल्ने भने
फेरि जाउँला भन्ने लाग्छ नि खै अब धेरै पैसाहरू गरेर फेरि जाउँ मन जागिरी खाऊँ भन्ने त लाग्छ तर पढ्न जागिरी खान त्यस्तै मन लाग्छ तर
If Dalits try to better their circumstances, they are often met with violent retaliation by the upper castes. For Dalit women, this may include naked parading, beatings, or rape.
नहीं छुए बच्चा का तुमको मारपीट किया, आज कुछ सब मारपीट किया, घिसीट के मारा, पैर हाथ बांध दिया, आंख बांध दिया, मेरे साथ बलात्कार किया। पहले के दो भाग आता है तो हमको लगता है कि यह धरती तुम फाड़ जाओ, जो उससे हम चाहिए क्या करेंगे।
In several South Asian countries, there are specific laws in place meant to prevent atrocities against Dalits and punish those who commit them. Unfortunately, existing laws are rarely enforced, and Dalits who try to register their case are often at best ignored and at worst tortured by the police. This was also the case in Bihar, where a young Dalit woman was shot dead when builders fired more than 50 shots against Dalits protesting that Dalit land was being illegally seized and sold to commercial builders.
जिसका हम लोगों ने जाकर विरोध किया, उसके विरोध करने के उपरांत ऐसा हुआ कि उन लोगों ने गोली चलाना शुरू कर दी, जिस वजह से जो है कि चार लोग घायल हो गए, एक की जान चली गई। पुलिस की मौजूदगी में ही सारी कांड को अंजाम दिया गया है। इसमें पूरी तरह से पुलिस इन्वॉल्व, 50-50 नाल राइफल जो है और पिस्टल लेके लोग खड़े हैं, पुलिस देख रहे हैं लेकिन उस पर कोई कार्रवाई नहीं कर रहे हैं। बस हफ्ते उसे और कह रहे हैं कि आदेश देते हैं कि गोली चला, ये हर जन है क्या कर लेगा, बाकी जो होगा हम समझ लेंगे।
When Dalit women, children and men stand up and fight for basic human rights that others take for granted, they are often risking their lives. The United Nations have hundreds of pages of documentation of caste discrimination. The European Parliament have passed a resolution urging EU institutions and member states to help fight it. And international human rights organizations have stressed repeatedly that this is a massive global human rights issue. The UN High Commissioner for Human Rights has already committed to taking action against caste discrimination and is passing the torch on to all of us.
I commit to end caste-based discrimination and untouchability.
Does the contents of that video come as a surprise, or are you familiar with it? Does it come as a surprise for anyone? This is a very, okay, just taking a read of the audience. So that, there are many purposes to starting the conversation with that video. The first is to bring you right into the problem so that we can focus on the solutions. It's also to make clear that this is a global issue, certainly a pan-South Asian issue, and while there isn't sufficient documentation of the problem in other countries, I've personally been investigating and documenting the issue in many other parts of the world and supporting other efforts to do so. And there are at least 260 million people who are affected by caste-based discrimination worldwide. The issues, there are many issues that tie affected communities together. First is the idea that communities are so polluting that they are literally untouchable. The line between purity and pollution, or defiling entire communities by calling them untouchable, filthy, unclean, non-citizens, is a very strong common theme. The lack of either lack of legislation or the lack of implementation of legislation is an enormous problem. Assigning Dalits and others from so-called low-caste communities into occupations that are deemed simply too demeaning or filthy for others to carry, there is a strong connection here between one's occupation and one's descent, and it is the defining and distinguishing feature of caste discrimination, which makes it distinct from other forms of descent-based discrimination. The caste into which you are born, especially if you're at the very bottom of the caste system, predetermines the occupation that you are allowed to perform, which itself makes it very difficult to break out of a cycle of abuse and poverty. And of course, violence as a principal weapon of subjugation, particularly as inflicted on Dalit women, as a way of pushing down assertions for Dalit rights is also a common theme. In that context, we have with us a tremendous opportunity for a conversation about strategies within Nepal, and I'll try to talk a little bit about other countries in the process, that are actually working. And that is an amazing thing to be able to say. We are talking about centuries-old systems of discrimination that are so deeply embedded into society's DNA that it is difficult to see anything but difference, untouchability, and pushing away. And you saw from the children, it begins at birth. They are told throughout school, through their religious institutions, through the way they live and the work that they do, that there are differences, and that there are people who are so polluting that they should be deemed untouchable. How do you counter such deeply entrenched forms of discrimination? How do you battle complicity of the state in persecution and discrimination, and how do you do so in a way that moves forward and puts Dalits at the center of these struggles and empowers them to be actors of social change and the leaders in these initiatives? We have with us three incredible people who have done just that, and it's no small task to do that. As somebody who's worked on this issue, which is very close to my heart for the last 18 years, I can tell you we're in the presence of some of the most innovative thinkers and strategists and change makers on this issue today, whether in Nepal or elsewhere, and it's an honor to be on this panel with them. To begin, I'll just very briefly introduce our panelists, and then we'll start by having a conversation with each other, and at some point we'll bring you all into the conversation as well. Panem Sundas is a poet, writer, and businessman, and one of the most respected elderly leaders of Dalits in Nepal. Panemji has been working to respect, protect, and promote the human rights of the Dalit community in Nepal for over 40 years, including by penetrating the very important areas of knowledge production and how Dalit rights and Dalit communities are understood, learned about, and talked about in Nepal. He's a founding member and executive chairperson of Samata Foundation, which is the only Dalit-centric research center and think tank in Nepal. And he's also a member of the recently formed Asian Dalit Rights Forum, which he'll also talk about today, which is the first pan-South Asian effort at addressing these issues at the regional level. In addition, he has served as a member of the National Level Advisory Committee under the Office of the Prime Minister for the Eradication of Caste-Based Discrimination and Promotion of Dalit Rights. Panemji, welcome. To Panemji's left is Sarita Parya, who is fast emerging as one of the most dynamic Dalit leaders working on social justice issues in Nepal. She is a board member of the Samata Foundation, which I just described, a very well-respected think tank working on the rights and dignity of Dalits in Nepal. And in addition, she is involved with several activist groups in Nepal and regularly participates in various forms for social justice, democracy, and media within and outside of Nepal. She recently announced a new Darnal Award for Social Justice Leadership Award, named in memory of her late husband, Subhash Darnal, who was a visionary and a tireless advocate for the rights of Dalits and who inspired my own work in this area deeply. It's an honor to have you here. And last but not least, to my right is Rain Bahadur Bike, who is the president of the Jagran Media Center, which he co-founded with Subhash Darnal, and in order to lead media advocacy efforts against caste-based discrimination and untouchability. Ramji is also one of the key persons behind a very successful television series called Dalit, and we'll watch a clip from that in a few moments, which dealt with Dalit issues and was aired during prime time in Nepal. He has helped train several hundred journalists from the Dalit community and was a pioneer in setting up and running several community-based radio stations that again dealt with issues of caste-based discrimination. And I understand he's now helping to promote these kinds of efforts across South Asia. Welcome. So, Padamji, let's start with you. Can you start by sharing with us the experience of discrimination in Nepal today, in 2014? What does it mean to be a Dalit in Nepal, and how has that experience changed over time? Has it changed over time?
Thank you, Dana. First of all, I'm very much honored to be here in this very significant conversation. Thank you, Asakji, and your all team that you invite us here and give us opportunity to participate in this program. And thank you, Nirala. It's our, I think, third time meeting. That's why we have been some job for the development. I think I should not just tell again about the problem of the Dalit community. Everybody, I think, knows that what is the problem. It means we are not actually, we in Nepal, we are not considered as a full man. Sometimes they say us pony. Pony means the quarter man. And we are still not considered as a full human beings. It's 70 years long, we are just struggling for this upliftment and eradication of this caste system in Nepal. And luckily, we should say that we are in the process of making some constitution until now. I mean, after this 70 years long struggle from the Dalit community also, the legal process of these laws and all the constitutional matters were against us. They are allowed to just say us in low-class people. But fortunately, after this constitutional making progress in 19, after this constitution making process, that we got the chance that the interim constitution just made the provision of inclusive democracy in Nepal and caste-free state. By that constitution, the constitutional election was held up, and 50 out of 600 people, 50 people were just elected as a constitution and assembly members to write some rights for the Dalit people. Mm-hmm. And unluckily that first CA constitution assembly was dissolved. Due to some political problems and some political conflicts between these political parties. Anyhow, that at that first constitution assembly, the rights for Dalits and rights for women was very progressive and very hopeful for the eradication of the problems of the caste discrimination. Unluckily, that failed, but anyhow, in the second time, again, we have got 40 CA members from Dalit community, and though its number of Dalit people is decreased, but we are hopeful that the constitution making process will run in full process, and whatever that good things were just passed by the first constitution assembly. We are fighting to reinstate that things in the constitution, and some of our very conscious Dalit leaders and CA members are fighting to reinstate the same problems. I think within this year the constitution is to be made, and we are hopeful. So there is some little bit problem that scenario of the first constituent assembly and the second constituent little bit changed.
Mm.
The progressive party now in the second position.
Mm.
In the first time, the progressive party were in the front line and they were just making the new constitution for the complement of women and the Dalit people. But this time, it's little bit the scenario has changed. And it is difficult to reinstate that good things which were supposed to be written in the constitution. And this is the problem, but we all from the marginalized communities, say Dalit, women, Muslims, and Malaysi, we are all now together and just trying to reinstate that problem. And I think it will help us.
You mentioned that. Not being considered a full man, a quarter man, what would a Dalit woman say? How she is considered, and also, can you talk about Dalit women's representation in the constituent assembly? We were talking about it before.
You see, historic thing that the women from Dalit community to win in the constitution, to be elected in the constitution. Last constituent assembly we had. Three women were elected out of seven. And that's, you know, the system of election is 50% from the proportional representation from all the communities and 50% from the first party post. In that first election, seven Dalits were elected. And out of seven, there are three women were elected. But unluckily, this time, the number of the number of the constituent assembly members from the Dalit communities is decreased. Only 40 are there and non-women are elected.
No women at all.
Women. But in the proportional representation, there's 50% means we have 21 women Dalit members.
And we were talking before about the controversy over numbers. The issue of proportional representation relies on the idea that there is actually agreement on how many Dalits are actually in the population. Can you speak to that, Sarita, and talk about the issue around numbers? What percentage of Nepal are we talking about? And also, in addition to that, what are some of the social and political obstacles that you face, or Dalit activists face, in trying to push forward a human rights-based agenda for Dalits in the country?
Yeah. Thank you so much. Actually, I'm very happy to be here today. When I entered in this room, I felt something vibration actually, because you see the paintings and there was the some music about the Dalit teleserial, and it really makes me very happy. When we talk about Dalit women, actually, first I think the primary things we need to know about is it's not the homogeneous group, right? There are multiple layers of women. Basically, in the context of Nepal, like, people, when they talk about women, they are just talking about like high caste Hindu women. And we are just only talking about their being victim in a multiple way, meaning like one from the class level and the second about the gender level, right? But I think we are totally forgetting about the caste point of view that we are facing the problem. So I think before I talk about political obstacle, I think I should address about the social obstacle too, right? So I just, I think most of the thing that we really watch in that video just we shot in that, right? Because what it means to say is, when we talk about human rights, first, we need to be human. And we are actually really fighting for to be a human first. And then the right it comes later. So in saying this, I don't know how to put these things in a word, but I don't want to actually portray Dalit women as only being a victim, right? Because they know they have really, what it called, developed their indigenous skills and strategies that how to survive first. They have amazing kind of actually knowledge, which I think that most of the other women, they don't have to face it, right? So I think the first thing is to talk about survival is the first thing, and then the it comes the like political, economics, education, and then other rest of the things, it comes later. So I think, of course there is a very serious kind of, human right violation toward Dalit women, but besides facing that kind of worst human right violation too, actually they happen to commit it themselves and come in front of, participating in politics or getting education and then other things. So, now I feel very good when there is like 21 CA members. Mm-hmm. And it's a very big thing in the history, right? Just we saw that how much actually we are facing problem regarding being as a Dalit women. And you can't expect like everything at once, right? Because from that level you come in, in a policy making level, it's a drastic, change. So, I think, but actually they are making, let's talk. I think I can't say everything at once, but we'll come with the conversation.
Can you answer the question, what percentage of the population?
The, 50, when we talk about Dalit population, it's according to the official record, we have 30% of Dalit, right? So among them, of course, 50% is Dalit women, yeah.
13% of the total population.
Total population, yeah. Officially, but...
90%?
1-3?
1-3, 13.
13?
What, sorry?
Yeah, that's the official, but it's around 18 to 20%.
Yeah. The unofficial estimate is 18 to 20. The government's estimate is 13, which makes a huge difference for proportional representation or any sort of affirmative action or reservation measures.
Yeah.
Ramji, let's come to you for a minute. We Sarita talked about as a first step being made human before human rights can even apply, which is also something that was said in the documentary. Your organization or group, Jagran Media Center, has approached this issue from the point of view of using the media and popular culture for many, many purposes, but would you say that one of those purposes is to humanize the issue, sensitize? And generally, can you say a little bit about why you created Jagran Media Center, why you felt it was necessary, and some of the work that is done?
Thank you, Rishmita, and all the panelists and the distinguished participants. First of all, I'd like to give the thanks to Ashok Guru and all team of India China Institute, and all of you having us. Especially we're talking now, I think you have, I have to say many things about our issue and problem. I think you already know. And while I was sitting there and I watching the documentary, and I saw the picture, some art in the wall, and then I found that Gandhi is there, something maybe. Yeah, I don't know whether that is Gandhi. And then some art I saw, I think everybody can think differently. I think there are some agendas that conflict, some they are feeling called peace, yeah? Some they are asking some justice. I don't know, I compare to both the art and my documentary. So especially the Padma Sundasya Sarita has shared many things about the Dalit issue and problem. That's why already you are familiar with, and then we are here from the different part of the country, different country from different part of the world. I think everybody we are suffering and facing different level of poverty. That's right. In the globally, we are fighting for social justice. Even now, I remember the Ambedkar, Nelson Mandela, and then Martin Luther King. Since long time, they fight for social justice. But what happening? Still we are suffering this. Even I am from Dalit domains, from Sundar Sarita and Matam. But I will, in the village we are suffering day to day, same thing. Even now, even I am here, it is even yesterday and the day before yesterday, I read the newspaper. What is the Dalit teacher? He did not get rent room. And one Dalit girl, in the caste marriage, they got problem. They have got problem. Even they exist from the society. That's why day to day, we don't have one day where we don't have any event from the Dalit community. So I don't go about the more about other things. Just I want to just I want to relate it to other things. Even now we are talking this the 21st century, and this is the time of media, you know, in the communication is very powerful tools and society. But even a kind of one powerful of media in the global we are thinking. So especially the 13% Dalit in Nepal and youth within the South Asia, the youth population, they live in the rural area. There are many problems and the issues. But there is a big gap. No, media doesn't give priority to raise Dalit issue and problem. So and then we feel we need media organizations because we have media. We have media like even Nepal after the restoration of democracy, 1990, we have grew a lot of media like television, radio, community media, social media. But there have. But I feel we don't have media. I need media because other media, with the so-called media, they doesn't talk and write about us. That's what we feel, and then we started Dalit Media Center in 2000. And then we started training to Dalit youth for journalism, and then we started produce a radio program and share to all over the Nepal. And we start publication some, and now we have Dalit Media Center has one radio station, and then we have produced one television, the software, 52 episode television. And then now we are feeling the media can change, media can do everything. That's why systematically, the local level, national level, and within South Asia level, Dalit Media Center went working for Dalit community through media mobilization. I think it's okay. Maybe we'll add other things.
What I find so interesting about, and actually we can, I see people already raising hands. If you want to come into the conversation, that's fine. Can you have a question?
What you're referring to with media, I'm interpreting as public relations. Mm. Is that what you're talking about?
Sorry?
When you say media, he's interpreting it as public relations. Are you talking about public relations when you say media?
But media is a public relation. Which type of public relation?
The difference is that media in this country refers to all the ways in which people communicate, all the technological ways, the literacy that's required, watching television, and all that sort of thing. Public relations is all the ways in which people try to communicate their message to others. And it seemed to me that what you're talking about is public relations. What you're looking for is ways to communicate both within the Dalit population and beyond the issues and the problems and the concerns. Am I understanding correctly?
No.
Maybe you can give us a few more concrete examples of the kind of work that Dalit Media Center does, and then I think we'll open up to questions after a little bit more on the panel. Thank you.
Publication material, he or Gravani was a way of facility of power or water right now. Stichapura, the issue of Kalimura, the political Kurakis, and the behaviors of the facility for the ones to write.
And
one,
I think, is media on a few good identity of people who are
mainstream
media. Especially
like the Dagra Media Center established. Or run by Dalit community. and especially focusing Dalit media centers and focusing on Dalit issue. That the which like you have show here, sorry, like lot of issues here. And that the mainstream media doesn't give priority and doesn't like speak. That's why we raise our issue from our media. The human diet violation, like and the political issue, development issue. So what is the Dalit problem? So what we have a policy of Dalit. So the people to people connection within Dalit community as well, gender conflict. Mm-hmm. What is the problem of Dalit? And how we have to solve and the communication between the gender people and the Dalit community.
What I find
especially focusing on Dalit community.
What I think is so innovative about your model is, especially having done this work in other countries as well, and I really see what you've done as being a pioneer in the region on these issues, because it's not just about telling the media cover Dalit issues more, but it's actually putting knowledge production in the hands of Dalit activists in order for them to communicate their issues from their perspective, from their voice, using multiple mediums. You've talked about radio programs, you've talked about newspaper, social media, and then in a short while we'll see a clip from the teleseries or the soap opera, as you've called it, which is a very mainstream primetime television serial that you have used very successfully to create movie watching clubs or film clubs, as you call them, but we'll get to that soon. But I think it's just to say, from the perspective of someone who's worked on these issues in multiple countries, including in India, Nepal is actually much further ahead in some ways. Nepal often is seen as trailing behind India in the region on some of these issues, but I actually think in many ways you've become pioneers and you've also been working with others. Badamji, can you say a little bit about also situating this in the South Asian context? You have been recently formed Asian Dalit Rights Forum. You have also been working across the region with parliamentarians. And there is a great move, you know, I've been involved in helping to internationalize the issue, the international network. What is the benefit that you see of taking this struggle outside of Nepal to the region? What benefit do you provide others, and how does it help to fortify the struggle within the country?
Actually, this problem prevails in the South Asia mostly, and wherever this Hindu people go, they take this system themselves in now in the other countries also. And what we thought that the activism that we are doing in our country level also, until and unless if we just not act as a globally unified or say first as a SAR level, we thought that if never the caste system will be demolished in Nepal, if it remains in India, again that will be continued. So what we thought that at least in this SAR level where there is a caste system, actually in India and Nepal, and thirdly in Bangladesh also, we found about more than 6% Dalit people there. Mm-hmm. But consistently they are not defined as a Dalit, or they are defined as a low caste people, but they are surviving from that discrimination point of view. So we thought that at least we should start from these 7 countries to unify our activism in the SAARC area level. Then after, we'll just go out of the country. That's the first of all. There are 3 things that we are thinking. That one level, this civil society level. That ADRF means Dalit Rights Forum is the civil society movement jointly organized in this SAARC level. And this member of that one is India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka now. And I think there is some people, some discrimination, some caste discrimination in Afghanistan also, but we are not sure. Mm. That's why we have not included the membership on that out of that 5 countries. And the ADRF, Asian Development Rights Forum, decides that from the civil society level we will do that work. And the main thing, when there is parliamentarians, you see, in Nepal, this is the first time by this new constitution making process, the Dalits are elected as the parliamentarians. And since from last 60, 70 years, the parliaments in India, they are elected from the reservation system. But still, we have heard that. Still, they are not raising any voices from the Dalit community, you see. They are just the cadre of the parties only. And it may happen in Nepal also. But until now, it's not a problem. And the Dalit CA members, they are working for the upliftment and for the benefit of the Dalits only. And the main thing is to make favorable and Dalit friendly laws and everything for the, in the constitution. So that we are just expressing our, sharing our experience. The last time that in Bangladesh people, there is no any laws about Dalit or any discrimination. That's why they came to Nepal and just then took our experience that we have passed that 2011 Untouchables Act. See, similarly, there are we have to learn more from India also, because the, most of the laws for discrimination is just we can just take this experience from India. So to make a good laws and legislative things, we have to just lobby with the parliament. You know. So that's why last year in December we have just made three parliamentarians from three countries, Bangladesh, India and Nepal. Unfortunately, that was the time that in Bangladesh there was just the parliamentarian was, there was no parliament election was declared. Similarly, it was happening in India also. That's why from India, only one parliament didn't attend that. But from Bangladesh, six parliamentaries were there. Now, unfortunately, in Nepal also, the first party post-election system was declared. Only two were elected from our community, and the proportional representation from that 50% city was not declared. So, only very few parliamentaries were attended, and they have declared that there should be one parliamentary home in Sharp area. Mm-hmm. And this time we are just planning to have that parliamentary meeting on this November 3rd week. Just to make a unified movement, mm-hmm. one from the civil society side, this is ADI, mm-hmm. and one for this legislative point of view, this is the parliamentary meeting that we are doing.
And these two are, I mean, these are also very sort of path-breaking examples. And I've personally seen how our friends from Nepal have worked across the table from our friends from India to learn about some of legal strategies and others, how you've passed on media strategies to others. Movements are now blooming in Bangladesh and Pakistan, which was unheard of even just a decade ago, because of how many layers of sort of, there's a lot of invisibility within those countries. It's practiced primarily within the Hindu minorities in those countries, and so you have to get through so many layers of first the minority and then the minority within the minority. But you brought religion into the conversation. I think it's important to have that conversation, and saying that the system goes wherever Hindus go. Well, there is a documentary in India I'd highly recommend to all of you called India Untouched, and some clips from that were actually used in this brief. And it actually shows how caste travels across religion, the ways in which caste is fundamentally an economic order that, in my view, allows for the abundant supply of cheap and even bonded labor, and how untouchability practices are cross-cutting in India, at least, across Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, Sikhism, and Hinduism. And I think that's a very important point to make, because there's a power in this system, and who it benefits and who it degrades, that goes beyond one particular religious institution, and it has traveled with migration to communities, including right here in the United States, in the UK. There's much more robust evidence there. Sarita, I want to come to you, I welcome you to jump into any part of this conversation. But we've talked a little bit about, you started the conversation saying you're in this room, and what does it mean to be in this room? We talked about it being Social Justice Week at the new school. I think every week should be Social Justice Week at the new school, and everywhere. And then, Ramji, you talked about icons on these walls, and you'll see Gandhi. And it's very common to see Gandhi. It's very rare to see Ambedkar, right? And but I saw it on somebody's bag as they were walking in. Was that it? There it is. Okay. So I don't need to introduce Ambedkar to this audience, but it matters how we construct history, how we construct contemporary issues. There are massive conversations going on globally around development agendas, what progress looks like, who's included, who's excluded, all of these things. And you and I were talking before about being here as important because we are in an institution, in a center of knowledge production.
Yeah.
What is it that you want to come out of these conversations here, and how can we keep moving it forward so it doesn't end here?
Yeah, this is a very critical question, actually. Because why it is critical, to be very honest, actually, we really don't only to be what it called so-called passive knowledge consumer, right? Of course, we want to be a knowledge producer. Meaning, of course, it's a very rare opportunity for us to be in this kind of platform, right? We have to talk about very practically. It's not like, okay, Dalit, they are poor, they are uneducated, they are backward, and then, you know, like that. But of course, getting this kind of platform and to be smart, to be outspoken, to express your things, you need to be, you need better education and international forums like this, and debate in public sphere makes a lot difference, right? So I think I was quite happy because when I was here to do auditing, like two clashes, and I happened to meet like bell hook sometimes what it called Thomas Piketty, and sometimes David Miliband, and then, you know, like, it was amazing experience for me personally, and I can tell that I'm very privileged because most of the Dalit women, they don't get this kind of opportunity, right? So I can tell that, okay, I'm this and that, but still within like 2 months or 1.5 months, I can feel it, that how I feel like getting opportunity means, right? So basically what I am telling is actually getting opportunity is most important thing for all people, because let me take one example. In one hand, when we talk about Dalit and non-Dalit, I always used to think when I was child that why on one hand Dalit children, they like to go in school, and other hand, why like Dalit children, they don't like going to school. Because it's not basically that you don't want to go to school, right? Everybody, they want to go to school, as we saw in that picture too, that body, that girl, she was just 14, and then she's compelled to earn money for just to survive, and even though she wants to go to school, but she's not getting opportunity. So meaning here is getting opportunity is very important thing. So I was happy that at the new school they have a separate, what it called, Department of Social Justice. And even though India China Institute, they really work near, or India and China, the relationship of it and its impact rest of the world. But our country lies in between India and China, and it has a definitely directly and indirectly kind of what it called impact. But getting this platform is something very, very special, that New School is really committed to the social justice, right? Because as Ashok Diamond said, that it could be very general things for non-Dalit people. They can just come from New York or getting different kind of things as an opportunity. But for us, it's important. So I think this is how, I mean, things will change. Otherwise, I mean, nothing is going to change, right? So, yeah.
Maybe during the Q&A, I'll invite others to give ideas for how we can keep this conversation going and not have it be a one-off event to bring these voices and perspectives into mainstream conversations. A lot of people want to jump in, and I want to invite you. And we did want to share a clip from Dalin, which is the TV serial. And maybe, Ramji, could you just set up the clip for us? I think it speaks for itself, but just tell us a little bit about what we're about to see. And then I will ask you to share a little bit what reactions to this have been and why this particular medium on this issue has been so successful. And just to prepare you, I'm going to ask you to reflect on strategies that might be helpful for social justice issues right here in the United States, where we struggle with our own forms of caste and class systems and separation in many different forms and aspects here as well. But to begin, if you could tell us what we're about to see.
First, I would say a little bit about the Dalan. During the establishment of Dalan Media Center, we have produced a very successful and very successful television, the Dalan. Especially Dalan, now there are 52 episodes. It's one of the path-breaking production of the Dalan Media Center by Dalan, a widely acclaimed TV serial that was aired by Nepal Television from 2007 to 2008 in 52 episodes, and that helped sensitize and public on caste-based discrimination and untouchability. And then the first I'd like to show short clips from Dalan Telsel, and then this short clips regarding the intercaste marriage. Because that in 1990, regarding the intercaste marriage, what is happening there, how is suffering about the intercaste marriage. So,
कटवाल कपाल काट्ने काम गर छिटो
हस प्रभु
Thank you.
आज विक्रमा सम्बत 2007 साल माघ महिनाको 29 रोज मंगलबारका दिन त्यस शीतलपानी गाउँका जिम्माल बाउसाय श्री खिल बहादुर चन्दको तजबिजमा तालुकदार श्री हरेराम बस्नेत तालुकदार श्री तुलसी प्रसाद शर्मा तालुकदार श्री मकरध्वज राठौर र तालुकदार श्री हरकमान मगरको रोबरमा ईश्वरलाई साथी राखेर गामले भाई भारदार चार थुम चार कुनाका जम्मा पारी धर्म नासिन्ना नदिन ओर परमेश्वरको निगाह गाममाथि राखी राख्नका खातिर ओर देश दुनियाँको दिल राखी रात चलाउनका खातिर कुलकी दमिनीलाई स्यारी हरिहर नेपालले जुर्मानी गराकाले निज हरिहर नेपाललाई चारपाटा मुढी जात काडी फेरि खोलो कटाउने निर्णय भएका छन्। निजका साथमा कुलकी दमिनीलाई पनि त्यही सजाय तोकिएका छ। आइन्दा उपरान्त निज जुर्मानीहरू तिनका शाखा सन्तानहरूले फेरि खोलो तरी आउन पाउने छैनन्।
Can you, were you all able to read the subtitles clearly enough? You, okay, so can you, so talk to us about, well, the reactions to, well, talk to us about that clip, but also generally, what did you set out to achieve by producing this serial, which I've seen from the write-ups is to illustrate the life, suffering, and upliftment of three generations of a Dalit family, and that you used a very participatory approach in its production, in the writing of the script, utilizing intensive discussions with Dalit scholars, writers, activists, film critics, and journalists, and that your purpose was to encourage a change in attitudes and behavior towards Dalits. That's a big task that you set out for yourself. So tell us the reaction and tell us how and whether you think you have managed to fulfill that goal.
Thank you. Within the 52 episode, we have capturing a lot of issues of Dalit community, but this is the one issue of like inter-caste marriage. So before we thought really it will be good or not, and the society will accept or not, that we have doubt. We spend a lot of money. Mm-hmm. Even issue was very different, and then now people thinking this is a different time. And then while we produce and we broadcast, then people do the day-to-day increase was Dalan. And then they started the Dalan Kalap. And then even child, even to elder people, and all caste group, and all level of people like civil society, leader, journalist, everybody, they watch the Dalan. And then even within the Dalan Kalap, there have the 75% from the non-Dalit community, youth generation.
75% of the film club members were non-Dalit members.
Yeah. And they have started within the society, like the against caste-based discrimination, the campaign, even school in enrollment, the campaign, and the health. But yeah, they have even day-to-day life, they are looking and everything, but really, we are doing this, so we have to go against this. Imagine, we can't imagine, but even they said, even you know, every people, they said 1 rupee. And we collect 30,000 Nepalese rupees. To one artist, really, one artist was very popular. And then, look, 1 rupee for this artist. Mm-hmm. And we collect 30,000. So even national, international, $500 was called. We have even in Cornell University in USA.
In the US,
South Asian country, as well as local level in Nepal. Mm-hmm. And most of the anthropology and sociology, this class, they really watch. Mm-hmm. They learn many things because this is the history. And even Nepal, the Tirbhum University, the mass media and mass communication department, students, they come whole night and whole day, they watch. Even 52 episodes, around 22 hours, we cannot sit. We have to give the whole 2-3 days. There was, and there even many, like now, they are writing the thesis on the Dalan. Even German, they have one they teach about Dalan script. That's why now we're starting, like, even now we have the film and documentary, they have started to produce some social issue. Mm-hmm. They're capturing even Dalit issue. Mm-hmm. So, amazingly, when we start the publish, the broadcast of Dalan, and then everybody just start, and they also start. This is also the issue we have to produce, and then, serial, like film. Even now, everywhere, is the film and the documentary we can show there. Some short part of like discrimination against. Now this is a good achievement to us. Mm. Yeah.
And you have noted in the brief that I saw that following, that some of the major activities that the film clubs have conducted so far are film screenings, door-to-door campaign for Dalit rights, setting up their own theaters, theater or plays, social awareness against social stigma, cultural programs, and that their impact has been on increased social harmony through the clubs, united actions against all kinds of discrimination being carried out, and so on and so forth. I guess, and to wind back over here, Sarita, so we have here sort of multiple generations of Dalit leadership at the table today, and you're talking very much about the role of youth in these clubs, both Dalit and non-Dalit youth. Can you say something about, I guess, the youth as a vehicle for social change? I feel old saying that now, but can you say something? And also, are the wants, strategies different between generations? Do Dalit youth want the same thing as Dalit elders wanted?
I think I need to tell a little bit about that, Dalit, so that it will be clear. The general things that I really got from that Dalit ritual was, actually, it impacted a lot. Why? Because I think caste-based discrimination and untouchability, of course it is culturally embedded, but even though people they try to give up, but they can't do it because it's been shifting from generation to generation. But sometimes people, they are unaware of that, and then they unknowingly they do it, right? So, but that was a kind of message that really non-Dalit people, they got that, okay, we have done something wrong in the history. And it is a good time to really change ourselves, and we should do that thing. I think that was the message that really Nepali people and those who have been living outside the Nepal, I think that message they got from this Dalit. So, I think when we talk about the new generation, I think so, to some extent yes and no, because of course that we all want a caste-based discrimination-free society, mm-hmm. right? Being as a young Dalit woman, what I can tell is it's a generation gap. Things are changing Nepal is changing. So it's not like even though they feel amazed at what kind of things you're facing, actually, just incident happened in my class at the new school, that when I talked about this thing, my friend was so amazed. Vladimir was very amazed that, what are you talking about, untouchability? So, you know, like something which is, I think the reality is beyond the imagination, actually, which exists till now. So even though people are amazed, but I think things have been changing, but the discrimination is also changing in a modern type of thing, mm-hmm. way, right? Mm-hmm. So it all depends that who you mate, with whom you eat, with whom you, go or, talk, right? So it all determines that who you are, and I think that is what the thing, the new generation, they are facing, because people, they generally say, okay, now it doesn't exist, right? Because there is no constitution, they have already mentioned that we are we all are equal. There is no any discrimination in front of constitution. But actually, it doesn't happen in practice, right? So we now, the young generation, actually feeling, facing in a different way, mm-hmm. right? Even though we are in a master's level, my friends, they are not openly, they are telling that we are belong to Dalit. So, you know, like, even though they are educated, but they can't tell that I'm Dalit, because if they open or disclose their caste, they don't get rent, right? So meaning there are rampant, discrimination, which is, happening, and even though it exists in a subtle forms. So I think the differences among what it called, like old generation and new generation, is, as I told before, that it's about the knowledge-based advocacy, that which we really want, right? So, it's not easy task that, okay, one night or 1 year or within 5 years it goes away, but we really want to do that, and I think some of that they have, at least they have initiated that work. So I would also like to add is, actually, we just did one research that from the establishment of organizing Dalit people, I think the most of the 60 years and 70 years in the history of Nepal, Dalit movement, they have always been investing their time, effort, energy only in two things. One is on entering temple, and the second thing is organizing co-fest, right? Co-fest. So eating together. So why I'm saying this is, actually, it's a kind of contradictory thing, because in one hand, we are talking about that we should go against Hinduism. Mm. On the other hand, our whole time, effort, energy have been investing only in entering the temple.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know whether if I'm not wrong, I mean, I think, is this the real time or the, I mean, good time to think critically that what we are really looking forward,
mm-hmm.
right? So I think this is what the new generation, I think they have this kind of challenges instead comparing with the old generation. Of course, I mean, it's not like, okay, this old generation, they are just only doing, I mean, on use or say, things that which are not important. Of course, it is important at some point, but now things have been changed, right? So that is one thing in way of, the second thing is, I think, young generation, they really have to participate in our politics too.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, politics is all about, right? So, meaning, even though it's hard, when you enter into politics, it's not easy task that to make a change, but still, because I can take example of the Dalit CM members whom I used to meet, like if I talk about specifically Dalit women, I could see the real change of previous Dalit CM members and after the, I mean, before 2011 CM members, right? You can see the huge change because at that point, women who are just doing tailoring work, they just pick up, and like Chamar women, they just, when they were working in the field, they just pick up from that level. But after some period of time, when they are used to participating in different kind of political forums, actually, they were able to enhance their capacity. So what it tells is when one get opportunity, that definitely people, they can do it, right? So here I would like to emphasize is, even though we have not got everything that we expected from our, I mean, political leaders or from everyone, but still I can say that it's all about opportunity. So I think I really want to encourage young people to involve in politics, right? Once you don't pay attention, then nothing is going to change. So that I would like to emphasize. Or, yeah.
We have a lot of patient hands, and I want to open it up to you, and I see you back there. I'll before opening it up and then inviting you to respond and engage in sort of direct conversation with folks in the room. There's so many interesting kind of themes that have been brought up that we could literally spend hours on each one. For example, all the decisions that were made on casting and how you actually, why is it that that's so effective? We could talk about identity politics. Madamji, you spoke about Dalits, Madhesi, Jandati, all united as part of a common struggle. And here we really talked about Dalit versus non-Dalit, but that's not the only axis or equation. And it's certainly not the only axis of power differentials that we're talking about. What does it mean to fight on an identity in politics, and what does it mean to unite with others? And we've also talked about generational issues, gender issues. You brought up a very interesting point, which is what I understood from your conversation, which is that now that rights are being enshrined in the Constitution, et cetera, it opens up some spaces, but it also closes down other spaces for critique, which is something I've seen in India. The conversation is very quickly deflected to, well, look at all the affirmative action, look at all the constitutional protections, look at all the laws on the books, therefore we do not have a problem in India anymore. And it, because de jure discrimination has ended, it sometimes closes the conversation for de facto. We don't have to go very far from the United States to talk about that. We're apparently in a post-racial America, depending on who you ask, of course, but that also, there's a way in which it closes that conversation. So that's also a way to bring everybody else into the room. I think, please introduce yourself when you ask your question. We'll take several at the same time, and we'll just have a couple of rounds back and forth, and we'll start in the back. Yes.
Hi, my name is Storm. I go to Lang. I study global studies, economics, and religion. You started to mention what my question involves, but I'm curious in the effect that religion has on unifying and identifying a community. So I was wondering what's happening to religious space as you work to end Dalit discrimination? And does this affect the ability the Dalit community has to work toward a unified voice and identity? As well as, is there a new view of Hinduism emerging, or are many Dalits detaching themselves from the practice as a whole?
My question was more along the lines of the idea of like human rights. And I was wondering if the half man becomes a full man, mm-hmm. What then does that leave the public history? The history around the public, how does that change if you become a full man? Does that change the idea of the history that has come before?
And can you identify?
Atiba, NSSR.
Thank you.
Yeah.
My name's Asta. I'm at NYU Law. I actually had two questions. The first one was you were saying that after the election of the new constituent assembly, there were a lot of progressive changes with regard to Dalit issues. But the second constituent assembly was far more conservative, just in terms of political makeup. So I was wondering whether you thought that there were any movements backwards with regard to Dalit issues after the election in 2014? So that's my first question. My second question was about federalism. So one of the most contentious issues in like writing the Constitution right now is about federalism. And whether what you thought was the best solution for addressing injustices against Dalit communities, historical injustices against Dalit communities within a new federal model, and whether that's even possible given the fact that most of Nepali politicians are upper caste, upper class men. How feasible that actually is.
I'll take one last question.
My name is Jasmine. I'm in the Theories of Urban Practice MA program at Parsons. I think the work of these larger organizations like the International Dalit Solidarity Network, the Samata Foundation, Asian Dalit Rights Forum, the Jagran Media Center, and the Darnell Award are contributing to the Dalit rights movement and also to the greater social justice movement. But I'm also curious to hear about if there have been any instances of small-scale local community organizing within Dalit communities in Nepal or South Asia.
Yeah. Thanks. Let's start with that round, and then we'll take another round. So in any order you want, and in any of the questions that you'd like to answer.
I think I'll go.
Sure.
I don't know if I understand correctly the question which is raised by Storm. I think regarding religion, what I found is now, these days, most of the Dalit people actually, they are really changing their religion. They're converting, Christianity, right? Because once they follow the Christianity, they feel like they don't feel any discrimination there. But what interestingly happening is actually it's not true, because within the Christianity there is still discrimination exists, right? So you know, like of course when we talk about this point, we'd like to remember Ambedkar, because he also converted a lot of Hindu people into Buddhism, right? So I think changing religion is not, I mean, at least now the debate is going on in Nepal, is changing religion is not the solution. And we need to fight against within our own religion so that we can get a better life. So in terms of religion, this is only what I can say. Thank you.
I'll agree with Sarita. Actually, in the South Asia, the Hinduism create caste system. Caste system create discrimination. You know, that is not created by the political, not created by the economic. First, we start from the Hindu religion. Even now, we can see the people, like the Dalit, most of the people, they're changing the religious, like Christianity. But within the Christianity also, there are leading by high caste. That's why within the Christianity also there have discrimination. That's why even India we can see there Christian Dalit and Hindu Dalit. Within the Christianity also we can see Dalit Christianity and I caste Christianity. Mm-hmm. So root cause is the wrong, like especially established by the Hinduism. Even he born within the Hindu society. And after he became the Christianity. And then even he is now Christian, but he has everything, mindset, everything in the Hindu, but outer he is the Christianity. That's why in practice, he has doing everything, like the same things within the Christianity also. That's why this is a difficult also. That's why people think, yeah, he said that most of Dalit, the people thinking, as a kind, Dalit is just poor, they are the, like deprived from that. Everybody, they are making the charity and the kind of kinds. No, that is. Everybody, if they don't think the main prize issue, we cannot change. Even I want to say with you, even if every, so I'm very serious. I'm just taking seriously. But in practically, nobody want to bring, do anything. And then orally and in paper, we are really very serious, we have to do, so we have to, maybe. But in practical, nobody like to do. Bring and do, don't like anything. That's
politically, one question is which way? I vote for federalism to Dalit people. I think. Actually, Dalit people are scattered all over Nepal. And there is no any specific area where the Dalit people can stand and win the race. And so, we Dalit people just, some very few people just demanded a state for Dalit, separate state for Dalit. Very few people. Yes, we have to just make research. All over Nepal, about 10 to 15 people were just trying to have a federal state, or just they were canvassing for it, but demanding for federal state. But most of the political parties and most of the intellectuals and most of the religious, they said that to have a Dalit state in a very small area or very low percentage of population, that doesn't mean any benefit to Dalit people. That's why, especially the identity of Dalits is that very, one side we are just trying to have our identity, and that our identity is to be. This identity is to be to dissolve, as in ultimately with this identity will be finished when we will be equal to society. That's why for the first time in this starting, our identity is to get the opportunity, get the right for Dalits. And ultimately, this identity will be, after some years, it will be finished when all the other people will be equal to other people. That's why what we thought, our political parties also demanded, there should be special representation in all these sectors, political parties and all in this government table also, there should be a special right. Proportion right is equal to all, and above that we need additional representation as a compensation, so that ultimately at some point we will be equal to others. Mm-hmm. That's the main thing. That's why we only saying that federalism is very essential to Nepal. Because the centrally located government is failed, that's why we need a federal system. And there are some historical things. As we know that people say that the caste, federalism as a caste, is not good for Nepal. But actually, when we talk with indigenous people also, they are not demanding caste-based terrorism. Mm-hmm. They are just demanding the, as a historical things one did. That's why the rumor that was made by elite people is a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
That's why all people think that Dalit people, what is the meaning of terrorism to Dalit people?
Mm-hmm.
But we think to have a very decentralized rights, we need federalism, and we are in support of the federalism, but in all the federal state, we want a compensatory representation in all the spheres. That's the thing.
There was a question about grassroots, which perhaps I could help answer. There are incredible and amazing examples all over South Asia, in particular in Nepal and India, of grassroots activism. In fact, all of these international, regional manifestations are outgrowths of domestic efforts, and there are many organizations we could point you to doing incredible work at the grassroots level. These really have, all of these networks have come out of that manifestation to start, and in my view, in terms of theory of social change, it actually doesn't work to do it the other way around, to stop at the, to start at the top level and then to grow. The growth has really come from below, and I'd be happy to talk to you separately about examples of activism or initiatives of groups that are doing that. I don't think we've answered your question about, well, we kind of talked about identity a little bit in terms of what happens, but I think what your question is reminding me of, and what others have talked about when we talk about Hinduism and others, is there's a question of what is it that we are fighting for? Are we fighting for the elimination of caste-based discrimination, or are we fighting for the annihilation of caste altogether? Because, and that's the question that Ambedkar asked, of course, because if a Brahmin continues to exist, to use that as a stand-in for whatever it's a stand-in for, power, privilege, if that role continues to exist, then how have you really addressed the system as a whole? If white privilege continues to exist in the United States and racial supremacy continues to exist, is it enough to address the discrimination, just the discrimination on the other end, without tackling the entire system? And that's at the root of the identity issues that we're talking about. On the reservation piece, a good friend of mine, Martin McQuan from Nafsarjan, whom you all know. Nafsarjan is a great example of grassroots work active in over 3,000 villages in Gujarat. He said, you know, with reservations, he wanted to turn it on his head, which is to say that the upper caste communities, which once all the communities are accounted for, are actually a minority in the population, in India at least, that the reservations should be for upper caste communities and everything else should be left open. And that is actually a much more radical transformation politically, because what's happening is that we never ever see representation beyond the reservation point for communities. It becomes a ceiling, and we see over-representation of men, of upper caste community members in the other. So I thought that was an interesting strategy to suggest that give them the reservations and leave everything else open. But that was one idea. Let's take another round of questions. Actually,
just little bit, just now we have a big debate about the attachment in Nepal, but whatever we'll go to conclusion, the identification. But especially we are looking the opposition within the federalism. Federalism will support like a political and economically with equality, whatever. But what is the society? If we have federalism, within the federalism also, there have untouchability and discrimination. What mean? Federalism will not do anything to us. That's why we are not, this is very sincerely, we are talking with now. Within the federalism, we need equality, all types of equality. And there should be end of the caste discrimination and participation and all. And from every opportunity we have to get, of all kinds of opportunity from federalism. That's why we are also starting that types of the topics now. Even India, we can show them, even the other country, we can show them within the federalism. The federalism cannot change.
Additional questions here? Yes.
Okay, two gurus. My name is Arjun Guru, and I'm from Guru Society, and I'm part of the organization here. and we are the indigenous peoples of Nepal. Mm-hmm. So we share a lot of things with other things. I have a question on the media, but before that, I just want to share one item. You know, Ramji's last name is Vishwakarma. Mm-hmm. It literally means karma of all karmas of the world, mm-hmm. or all traits of the world. Mm-hmm. Right? And it's named after a Hindu god called Vishwakarma, who is worshipped all across Nepal. And I think it's a great contradiction, and I think that people named after a god who's worshipped is treated this way. Mm-hmm. So the question, you know, we talked about Jagan media, why the need for Jagan media came up, and why you know, all these groups, including Janjatis, and Dalits feel that the mainstream media is not really fair to us. Right? And if I can bring into this conversation one of our friends who is here, Akhilesi, who is in the mainstream media, how does he see, you know, this acquisition, if I may say that. And how does he see the mainstream media really evolving and becoming fair to, you know, everyone? Mm-hmm. I mean, so I really want to, you know, hear you know, a little bit from that perspective, sure. because we can talk about from our perspective,
sure.
if he can join the conversation. Thank you.
All right, well. I love it. Audience to audience questions. Yeah. So you have been put on the spot. Yeah.
Sorry for that.
Will the you are presenting the day after tomorrow. That was the that's a good plug for the event on Thursday. Please do attend. If you don't mind, share a little bit of your thoughts on that question and introduce yourself as well, please.
Hi, my name is Aditya. I used to be a journalist. I don't think I can claim I'm one anymore. But I worked for the Nepali papers for some years. What has changed is, you know, I mean, over the last 20 years, but at an accelerated pace since 2006, there is an awareness in the media that these issues exist, that structural oppression is actually a thing that exists within Nepali society, and the media has to address it in some way. That is no longer an issue, you know. So that is a positive sign in my opinion. But on top of that, of course, there is we have a situation where the editorial levels, most of the reporters, all come from particular like upper caste groups. And it's very difficult for, you know, indigenous people or Dalits to find a place for themselves within the organization. Like the ethos is very different, you know, and there is a certain blindness towards kind of their concerns and the way they look at the world and the particular problems that they face, even among so-called progressives, you know, even among people who consider themselves progressives, there remains a blind spot. The second thing is, especially after 2008, the election, there was a period of time when entire, the Nepali establishment, that the kind of traditionally powerful groups, they were very deeply threatened. You know, it was even before that, you could say that, you know, there was some lip service paid to, yes, we need to be inclusive and we need to bring these groups in. But once the Maoists and the kind of Madeshi parties became a real political force, and it would threaten their power. So that kind of made them kind of more, you could either say it made them more reactionary, or you could say that it revealed their true colors. Now we have a situation where, you know, these parties are no longer powerful, they lost the election, and there is a dominant kind of trend which says that all this inclusion thing, all this inclusion rhetoric has gone too far, and we need to kind of pull back. We need to kind of go back to maintaining some order. So I would say that generally, but this, the fact that there is awareness, that no one denies that these things exist, is a politics, and everything else is, you know, all movements are go back and forth, and then they go, you know, two steps forward and maybe one step back.
Thank you for allowing yourself to be put on the spot. Let's take one more round of questions and then come back, sir.
My name is Hubert Weiler. I'm interested in the questions of religious social class divisions. The older I become, the more I think that discussing social justice is a complete waste of time. I think it has more to do with economic development questions. How do you create economic opportunities for the lower social class that is more than debasement? And what efforts are being done in the West, in Europe, poor people would go into the monastery where they would at least eat regularly and have a place to sleep and give them work. Mm-hmm. Now there were social class divisions even among the monks in the monasteries, but if you got into a monastery, you're doing better than if you were a peasant in the fields. We've mentioned it a number of times, but we haven't talked about the social infrastructure of religions, Buddhism or Hinduism, and how the Buddhist monasteries or the Hindu ashrams could work as a structure within which the lower social class could receive an education or find useful economic development skills.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Muna Gurum. I direct a small writing center at a high school nearby, and I'm a new member of the Gurum Society.
Yeah.
this question is, I guess, Renji or Banuji can sort of answer inside of that. For Renji, I was wondering if there is another episode of Dalit in the works, mm-hmm. or if you are thinking of another, you know, like what's next for something like Dalit? Is there another soap opera in the works? And also, I'm interested in the process of creating Dalit. Like, how did the writing happen? Was it more improv from the actors? Like, sort of your process of creating Dalit, and maybe a little bit on the radio station that you spoke about. Are there radio stories and poetry, and maybe you can talk about that too. Basically, any artistic collectives that are happening, because as a writer myself, I crave to see people like me in works of literature and art, and I'm just wondering about that.
Thank you.
My name is Javed, and I'm a Indian. I was curious about the relationship between the Muslim Dalits. Mm-hmm. Hindu parents, all the experience in Nepal, and I know in India there is a total separation, and in the Muslim there is a good segment of Dalits which faces the same caste issues here. And
thank you. We'll take our final questions in the back, and then others that we haven't heard from, and then over here. We'll wrap it up there.
Okay, great. Hello, Mr. Kangsha. I'm doing my PhD at Fordham University in social policy. And my question is to Sarda. I'm actually from India, and I've had the opportunity of being here and hearing Mr. Farad talk about how education, access to education is limited to Dalit communities, and first, particularly women, because there's a double discrimination in terms of class, caste, and gender. Access to English medium education in India is so limited. So we are automatically, Dalit women and men are automatically out of the whole globalization realm and access to opportunities, economic policies, social policies. So what is it that needs to be done differently for women, for communities, for individuals, at an individual level, at a group level, at a community level? You know, what is it that you see as a woman in Nepal that's different? Or what could have been done differently to really come up with something that would work?
Thank you. And the last question over here.
It's more of a comment. Having worked with the Nepali communities for many, many years, the origin of the caste system has always been interesting to me. I thought it was, 14th or 15th century? I thought actually it was the kings that were saying it was Hinduism. was the founder of the caste system. In the United States, it's not too different, even though people, like, even in the New School, keep working the idea of the middle class to extinction almost, because that's the basic preoccupation. The basic mantra in the United States is the health of the middle class. And as far as the comment about the media, for those people who are in academia, probably you would agree that in most instances throughout the United States, you have something important to say. First they ignore you, then they attack you, then they make fun of you, and then they join you, like in the climate change march. My question to all of you is, have you brought this particular subject to Democracy Now, which is global? Because I think that they would really run with it.
Great suggestion. All right. Some great questions in there. Let's do one more round, and maybe in your responses, you can also give some concluding remarks, given the time, in any order.
Okay. I think that's a very critical question, but of course, it's a very big question. Thank you so much for the question. I think I cannot give complete answer, but I'll try my best. As for my experience, what I have seen in my this short period of time, I think when we talk about education of Dalit people, it's not only about like one thing, right? It has to be done in a what it called complete package, meaning the primary level, when we talk about the students, actually, of course, when even they go, even they have access to go to school, but the environment within their house is actually not that much easy, right? So they have to take care of their children, I mean, sisters, brother, if they are, if their time is to, what is called, cutting grass or collecting firewoods or going to harvesting what is called crops, and then, you know, like they can't go to school, right? And the awareness of parents, actually, it has to come from their parents too, right? Because once they are educated, then they will compel their children to go to school, and they have to understand the importance first in the parent level. The first thing is that, and the second thing is, even though there are certain scholarships that have been provided from Nepal government, actually it is not monitored from very closely, right? Just you give the scholarship. And what I found very interesting example was, you got a scholarship in the school, and then the teachers, actually, they are just giving a scholarship to non-Dalit student too, because they think that non-Dalit students are also poor. And we should not discriminate within the students, so we are just giving a scholarship to all the students. And I think that we really need monitor, right? And the third thing is, I think, of course, it's about awareness level of parents. And then the third thing, the most important thing, is about the environment of school. I think I should give the example of Dom community, which I recently visited in Saptahari. You know, like, they don't get any kind of motivation to go to school. The first thing is, they feel very, very discrimination and untouchability within the class in two levels. One from their teachers, and then the second within the peer group. And they don't, you know, like, if they happen to sit in front bench, you know, like, they are never been encouraged. They're always been blamed that they are not qualified as non-Dalit students. And once you never get attention from your teachers, nobody want to, go to school, right? And they are compelled to leave school because they don't like going to school. And they feel very embarrassing. So, you know, like, these kind of things actually makes very difference. Actually, small things matters a lot, I think. You know, like, when we talk about big things, that's one thing, right? if you feel something there within the class, then of course the students, they really get motivation. And the fourth point I can make is actually our education system need to be very Dalit friendly, right? If you cannot get any stories, any your life experiences, reflection in your text, then how Dalit children, they want to go to school, right? So I think it's our, I think we really did a one good thing actually from Samata Foundation, that we, our prominent Dalit writer, his name is Aoti, who also wrote this script of Dalit Israel, that he wrote a book and we published that one, Class Struggle and Caste Struggle. And in Tribhuvan University in master's level, they have incorporated that book as a reference material. Meaning it's a big change. At least it has initiated, right? So I think if we make really the Dalit friendly education system, then it really helps. Only the thing is actually we really need the passion about it. You know, like just talking, okay, these are poor, you know, it doesn't work. So I think it has to be it has to come in a comprehensive package where the all things has to come together. It's not like solely one thing that, okay, this is the package that it would really do amazing things for the student. I think if we at least start from this point of view, then something will change, I hope. That's it. Thank you.
Can I take this opportunity to have one suggestion that I want to just add to Aditya's person? That is, he told that the scenario of this constituent assembly is changed, mm-hmm. You see? And we Dalit people, not only Dalit people, we indigenous people, women, all are very worried. Whether the things which was just passed or just supposed to be retained in the constitution from the first the CA members. This time the scenario has changed and the political party are not so willing to give you rights to the indigenous people, as for Dalit or women. That's why most of the elite peoples from Nepal who are holding all these authorities outside the political scenario, they get the chance to go in abroad and just tell provocate that the inclusiveness or the federalism will just destroy the country. They are just destroying our harmony in the society. But that is that is just a reverse point to us. Because we didn't get chance to say our voices in abroad or in the outside of the country. Mm-hmm. That's why this that I want to just take this opportunity to just say all this audience that the inclusiveness is the must this essential things to us and to the indigenous people also. The federalism, that's why the federalism we are just supporting the federal president. That's why. I will just give thanks to Ashokji and all this audience that actually the political parties, they are not willing to give the rights to the oppressed people, and just like Madhesi, Dalit, women, or distancing. That's why to give them pressure to the political parties, the outsiders from this, foreign people or foreign agency, they should just give pressure to the political party, to the government, just to do according the UN guidelines and principles for this elimination of the caste-based discrimination. Mm-hmm. Only if they will just follow that things, the government or the political party is forced to give the inclusion in all the sectors. That's why I'm just giving thanks to this form and to the new school. At least they gave us chance to say our feelings here in a very appropriate states. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Actually, Zion Desert has like a production house, and then we have a radio station. In the production house, like we produce weekly radio program, and one like political, one regarding human rights, and in general. And then we produce and share to all over Nepal, to like 300 to 300 community radio station. And they broadcast our program. And then we have radio station, it's run every day 18 hours. And then now it's run by Dalit community, but radio for to all, not only Dalit community. Within the our society, we have like other marginal community also, like women, Dalit, indigenous, like LGBTI, disabilities, like other marginal. That's it. Not we, only we alone, we cannot go. But we have to also respect to other issue. That's right. Other issue also, and we the radio from our radio station. So 60% time we are allocating to our social issue and political issue, and then other like some entertainment, and then like other. Mm-hmm. So the, and all from different group there have the staff, not only Dalit community, like Brahmin also they have to be sensitized on the issue. We don't discriminate to them, and then like in just all from all group there have staff. And then Dalan, I think it first time, this is the that was also the first experience to us. While we start, we think we need a documentary, I feel. What type of documentary we need? And even they have like broadcasting, like the different types of, they have a broadcaster, like many, we feel we have to go. Really, people, what types of serial want to? And we make question now. Mm-hmm. And we went to the five this regional level, regional location, and there are 500 people. We asked question, what types of serial you want to? And then we collect all questionnaire, and then start writing, description, like writing. And then we saw perspective from the sociology, we saw perspective from the like and the political level, even we call different type of people, and then we discuss how we can make better. The so what types of serial we need, and the time to time, even scholar, professor, all types of people, and at least 2 years we spend for that all process, and then we have started to like shooting, and then actually it was very participatory. And then even the Dalan, there have not only Dalit issues, we are capturing all types of, all marginalized group issues also there have. That's why, I think that's why this is very famous. That we are not anti, we are not going anti-movement. We want to respect an integrated movement. That's why, if we are going to start anti-movement, we will need support from even you, if I am going to talk against you, you will not support to us. That's why, integrated movement is good, but we have to think first. What we are.
Thank you. So I guess it's up to me now to wrap up. There's some questions that have not been answered, but I would invite you to continue the conversation. There was a question about treatment of Muslim Dalits and versus others. We'll continue that. There was a question about economic opportunities as being a focal point. In my own view on that question, I do think they need to go hand in hand. So many Dalits are systematically excluded from education, economic opportunities because of the stigma and discrimination that attaches to them as so-called untouchables, so that even if all opportunities were provided, they would still be excluded at entry points. And so I think those struggles have to go together. I invite you all to continue the conversation, to visit the websites and find out more about the exciting work that's going on here. Let our panelists know about the work that you're doing and also to exchange that information. Contact Amy Goodman and ask her to put this on Democracy Now. She's actually very accessible and wonderful to be interviewed by. And to please continue this conversation both within the new school and beyond. I'll simply conclude by thanking Ashok and everybody at the India China Institute for your incredible efforts to bring together this conversation. I thank you all for being a wonderful participants in this, and especially to all of you for being here. It is such an honor and privilege to sit next to you, and thank you for years of inspiration on this work. It's easy to deliver a lot of bad news, but to be able to sit amongst individuals who are actually doing exciting, innovative things and changing things in deeply, fundamentally structural and psychological, social ways is very exciting. Thank you all very much.